So guys, what's up? What today's topic is? Today's I'm talking about vapor pressure. This is going to be another short lecture. And after this vapor pressure is done, the next topic is going to be Rawls' law. However, I will take that in a separate lecture. So let's talk about the vapor pressure. Let me introduce to you about everything I want to tell you. The pressure exerted by vapor of a liquid or a gas over the surface of a liquid or the surface of a solution is called vapor pressure. This might be a little difficult to remember, so I'll make that happen going to be in the writing form as well. But let me repeat: the pressure exerted by vapor of a liquid or a gas over the surface of another liquid or over the surface of a solution under equilibrium is called saturated vapor pressure, or it's called vapor pressure, right? So let's write the defined part here. The pressure exerted by a gas or vapor of a liquid over the surface of another liquid or a solution or over a solution under equilibrium is called vapor pressure. It's called vapor pressure. So this is the defining part of the vapor pressure. Now I have to discuss on what factor the vapor pressure of a liquid depend, right? So for doing that, I'm putting you through something very interesting, or might be even easy. Just take a look here. Suppose this is a container here, this is a container, and you have a liquid here, and the liquid surface is represented by these small circles I'm drawing, right? So this is a liquid here, and this is your liquid. And what you do, if you heat, sometime heat is required, but there are many liquid where heating is not even required. For example, petrol, diesel, they evaporate on their own, so they are highly volatile. On the other hand, water and some other liquid required even heating. So for anything that converts into vapor, that is called a volatile substance, right? Anything that converts into vapor or a gas, from a different state, it is called volatile substance. So water is volatile, diesel, petrol, kerosene, ethanol, all the liquids you consider, they are volatile. Some may not be volatile under a normal condition, right? But you can make that any liquid to be volatile depending on the temperature required, in the form of the boiling point. Coming back to that, so we have a liquid here, and if you heat this liquid, what happened? This converts into vapor. Suppose these small circles represent to vapor, and they are separated by a certain gap, which definitely help you to understand that the gases have least possibly or have no force of attraction, so they are away from each other, right? So that is the vapor of the this represent to the vapor, and this is your liquid. Now what happened? These vapor actually apply a pressure on the liquid surface. They apply a pressure on the liquid surface in downward direction, and that pressure is called vapor pressure. That pressure is called vapor pressure. So in simple, when you start heating a liquid, you know, that liquid converts into vapor, right? And that vapor starts exerting a pressure downway onto the liquid or onto the solution. That pressure exerted under equilibrium is called vapor pressure. I hope I made you quite simple, right? Now, what we need to talk? We need to talk about what are the factors on which vapor pressure of a liquid depend. So that's going to be the next topic. So let's talk here. Factors, you know. So second one is going to be factors. The first factor is, you know, temperature. The first factor is temperature. Now, it's quite simple. When you increase the temperature, what happens? You know, the kinetic energy of the the system starts increasing, and therefore the liquid evaporate much faster. You know, so heat is responsible for increasing the, you know, formation of vapor, and if the vapor is increasing, definitely the pressure exerted by the vapor will also be increasing onto the surface, right? So in simple, how you can calculate, you know, that temperature T is directly proportional to the vapor pressure. Let me explain you here. If you start increasing the temperature, what will happen? More vapor will be formed. And if there are more vapor, there will be more pressure exerted, you know, in the downward way. So that's why, you know, the pressure will be increasing, right? So temperature is directly proportional to the vapor pressure. Let's talk about the second, you know, factor. The second factor is, you know, surface area. The second, you know, is surface area. There are many more coming up, but this one is again very important. Surface area. It's quite simple that if the liquid evaporating has higher surface area, greater will be the rate of evaporation. If greater will be rate of evaporation, definitely the vapor pressure will also be high. So what you can do, you know, surface area is also directly proportional to vapor pressure, right? Let's talk about the third one. The third one is boiling point. Now, there is something very important. You know, the liquid which have a lower boiling point, that will be evaporated faster. Liquid with lower boiling point evaporate faster, so they form vapor much more earlier than the liquid which have a higher boiling point. So what that means? Lower the boiling point, higher will be the vapor pressure, right? So I'm going to write that. So lower the boiling point. Boiling point I'm represented by BP, but don't get confused, it's not blood pressure. So lower the boiling point of a liquid, higher will be vapor pressure, or I should, you know, make it like, you know, inversely proportional to vapor pressure, right? So let's make it mathematical here. So boiling point of a liquid is inversely proportional to the vapor pressure. But let me explain you again. You know, if there are two liquids, let me take some example here. Suppose I'm talking about, you know, there are two liquids here, two container having two liquid. There is A here and another container is having B here, right? So A components, you know, are something like this. So this is the A here, and suppose this is the B representing here. So what is happening here? What is happening here is that, you know, the force of attraction here is less. Because the force of attraction is less here, what will happen? The boiling point of this liquid will be lower. So there the boiling point is lower. And if boiling point is lower, you know, then vapor pressure will be higher, right? And suppose there, what you can see that the molecules are closer. So what that mean? The boiling point will be higher. And if boiling point is higher, what will happen? The vapor pressure will be lower. So this is the, you know, relation between the vapor pressure and the boiling point. The next, you know, factor I'm going to explain you is the nature of the liquid. So that's going to be the fourth. Let me write it here. So this is the fourth one. Nature of liquid. Right? So it's again something that can be related right here, you know, but I'm taking some other example. Suppose I'm talking about ether. There is one liquid ether here and there is another liquid ethanol here. Just pay attention, ethanol here. So what you do know that ether, there is no hydrogen bonding, but ethanol, there is hydrogen bond. It has hydrogen bond, It has hydrogen bond. And hydrogen bond, however, the ether molecules are held by a weak van der Waals force. So there, the force of attraction is, the force of attraction is smaller. There, the force of attraction is higher. And if the force of attraction is higher, definitely the boiling point will be low. So in this case, so the vapor pressure is going to be high. And in this case, the vapor pressure will be low. So that's the nature of the liquid. Let me repeat this, nature of a liquid, how this affects the vapor pressure. If you are comparing two or more liquid and you are willing to find out the, the sequence of the vapor pressure, the very simple thing, if the force of attraction operating between the molecules of a liquid is high, if the force of attraction acting between the molecules of a liquid is high, definitely the vapor pressure will be low and vice versa, right? So that's how you can decide which liquid is going to have higher vapor pressure. Remember, lower force of attraction result higher vapor pressure, and higher force of attraction result lower vapor pressure. So these are four factors. And but there is one more which is very, very important, and there's something interesting coming, come right now. So let's talk about that fifth one, right? But for doing so, I have to take a little bit of space from here. Okay, so the fifth factor is purity of the liquid. This is very, very important. Purity of a liquid. Let me give you some example here, right? Don't pay attention right here. This is all gone here. So suppose we have another container right here, and this has water. Suppose this surface is occupied by water molecule. So what I'm talking, this is a liquid water here, and if you provide the heat, what happens? It forms a vapor. It forms vapor right there. So there you have this liquid here. This is the liquid here. Right, and this liquid can be called pure liquid. So I'm writing here pure. Why it's pure? Because I haven't added anything else right there. And these are the vapor pressure. Right now, what I'm going to do? I'm going to change the situation here. So what I'm taking? Suppose this very same container has water, but along with that I have added salt. So suppose these molecules, which I'm circling quite dark here or in bold way, they represent water, but this one represent to salt, so what will happen here? This might be even ethanol. Let's not make this ethanol, another liquid, ethanol. So what you have done here, you have mixed a certain amount of ethanol into water. So there the volatility of the water is more than that of the ethanol, right? In that case, what will happen? The vapor pressure here, this is a pure liquid, and there the vapor pressure is represented by P naught. Just pay attention. Vapor pressure of pure liquid. These are the important symbol coming up, so you need to concentrate on that. The vapor pressure of pure liquid is represented by P naught here. However, now this is a solution, and there the vapor pressure is represented by P, and this is nothing but vapor pressure of solution. Now I'm about to explain you what is the relation between this P and P naught. Now first, let me write the answer and then I will explain you. I'm just helping you out that P naught is greater than P. P naught is greater than P. Okay, pay attention why. I told you that if there is just one liquid and you are heating it, you will obtain the vapor of one liquid, right? But if you mix some other substance into that liquid, what will happen? The vapor pressure of the solution will start decreasing. Why it decreases? Because these molecules will only be able to form less vapor. Why? Because the surface area has been partially occupied by the ethanol as well. So there will be less vapor of water. Right? So what that means? If there is a pure liquid, the vapor pressure is high. If there is a, you know, solution, what that means, a solute has been added to the solvent, the vapor pressure decreases. What this can be represented like P naught, which is the vapor pressure of pure liquid, and P, which is the vapor pressure of the solution. So P is always smaller than P naught. Why? Because the escaping surface area, now concentrate on the line, escaping surface area for the solvent or for the first liquid having the lower boiling point, you know, is decreasing, and therefore it has difficulties to get at to get out in the form of the vapor, because the place has been partially occupied by the another liquid or another substance which is in the form of a solute, right? So therefore a pure liquid vapor pressure is always higher than the solution, right? So that is very important, and with that I must wind this lecture right here. In the next lecture, I will help you, about Raoult's law, because Raoult's law has something very important to do with this particular section, this purity of the liquid. But I don't want to make you go for a very longer video, so I will do that in the next lecture. I will say thanks for watching, take care, and have a very good day.